Sure there. Today's episode is fun with bridge rectifiers, and here we go. Little bridge rectifier and a big massive 28-pound power transformer from your phase linear model 700. Okay, a few modifications had to be done to this rectifier. First of all, there were little divots on here, and the manufacturer, I don't think, automatically assumes that somebody's going to hang too many things off of their rectifier legs. I kind of hoped that little blue clip-on things would have worked for this, but unfortunately, there are too many things that hang off of here. First off, there is AC in on these diagonals, DC out on these diagonals. AC also, I'm going to have to run a line to the direct current protection circuit, okay? The protection circuit has to be powered off of the rectifier legs or from AC in general. Okay, now that, and also we have to have little tiny snubber capacitors added one leg to one leg to one leg to one leg and return to the first leg. So what these do will smooth out any switching noise as it goes from positive to negative phase of the alternating current. I'll explain that in a little more detail in a few minutes. So here I am once again, long overdue, with a brand new camera that doesn't have autofocus. Well, it does have autofocus, but yeah, not going to use it. All right, and that means that I'm not really rebuilding an amplifier. I am setting up shots instead, which is going to occupy like 85% of my time in this project from now on. From the rectifier, we are also going to do infrastructure wiring. That is, from the AC input to the fuse, to leaving a place for front panel. Oh, good grief, I'm complicating it again all over. All right, you know, this is a big project. Another thing you're going to have to be aware of is insulating your mounting bolts, too, and I'll get into that, too. Of course, I've snipped a whole bunch of wires off this thing, and I know what has to be hooked up, but you don't. Well, you know, I'm doing this for people who are intrepid, who are beginners, who are not really familiar with doing all this stuff. I can't stress that enough. I know I'm going to go through a lot of stuff that experienced people are going to say, well, duh, that makes sense. But another person is going to say, well, why am I doing this? So anyway, for the sake of getting this truck on the track and getting this cow on the road, let me zoom up on this baby here and show you what's going on with that, and then we'll get on to the rectifier. So then, if you take your marvelous DeWalt DW100 power drill and joyfully and gleefully aim for that little divot hole that the manufacturer put in. And you marvelously have drilled all four of your rectifier legs to account for putting those extra little bits through there that the manufacturer never, well, you got a little bit of burring on the opposite side, so take care of that with your Dremel tool, and then you will be set to put this thing in place. Okay, now, to tease out what we have here, we have this terminal block here. These three wires, from yellow to gray is 6 volts. From orange to gray is 6 volts. From orange to yellow is 12 volts. This will provide power to your front panel LED meters. On previous models like the 700 and the 700B,
These powered the front panel illumination for the regular twitching needle meters. This right here, okay, we have an orange and green. Okay, an orange. Wait a minute, what do we got here? We have a brown and green. We have a brown and green. We have a yellow with brown stripe and a yellow with blue stripe. Okay, notice how these are there. Do not fiddle with those. These configure your transformer for use with 120 volts or 240 volts. So you don't want to fiddle with those, okay? You will, however, need to run a neutral AC and hot AC from your power input plug and, well, a fuse holder. These right here are AC output to your system, okay? These feed into the rectifier, like so, and this leg outputs negative, that outputs positive. This is your center tap of your transformer. That goes to a ground strap or a neutral strap, however you want to call it. Okay, so these are your wirings. These are the ones that you want to worry about for the moment. Okay, now go no further, and I will start hacking on this little rectifier and get the little snubber capacitors in there. Now, be aware, don't fiddle with these very much, because this is all the wire you have. You have no more than that. If you screw those up, you are going to be in a hole of problems, okay? Unless you can find another transformer to replace it. Okay, now let me review this and see if I got everything in the frame correctly, and I'll be back. And this is what we end up with. It actually benefits you greatly to... Oh, goodness, I'm looking at a TV over there because the mirror is flopped up and I cannot see through the viewfinder. Anyway, here we got nice, very well soldered. Do your little capacitors first. And closer. There we go. Do your capacitors first. And then connect your little wires to that. Now, know this. Okay, see that one in upper right corner. Notice how that is rotated 90 degrees from the other three. That is positive output. That is your B plus power rail. Okay, that goes to your positive side of your filter capacitor bank. This goes to your negative side of the capacitor bank. I will need two wires, one here and one here, to feed the DC protection circuit. And we have enough empty space in those little holes to plug in those little black wires. Okay, alright, so a minor detail. Watts Abundant supplies this coil of black wire to feed the DC protection circuit. It is very skinny, little, single conductor wire that is going to feed 120 volts into that DC protection circuit. And I thought, man, that's awfully skinny stuff to be running at such high voltage. Apparently the current draw is not that that great. So this is, hey, that's what they use, that's what they sent, so that's what it's going to be. And I keep thinking, well, you know, such a small little thing with the high voltage. But, you know, look, we plug our phones in to things like this, right? So, apparently, it's all about current draw more than it is about the voltage. So, okay, just be intrepid and go ahead and use what they send you, because apparently, and I did ask about that, and they said, yeah, go ahead. Alrighty then, so I'm going to go ahead. And there you have it. Okay, this skinny little black wire, going to go to the DC protection circuit. This again, that's going to go to that neutral bus. These, your AC out, these are the worst things because they're a very heavy gauge wire. And it took a lot to solder them on. Okay, and you have B positive right here and B negative right here. So you have negative out, positive out, AC in, AC feed to something else. Okay, your transformer is now ready, more or well, at least this part of it is. Let's talk about this happy little mess right here. They have originally white wires as hot. We don't want that, and black wire as neutral. Okay, let me just clean that out right now and get that ready to hook up.
I've mounted the transformer without telling you about insulating your bolts, okay?
All right, now we get on to one more little annoyance, and that is the transformer bolts. Yeah, these are the bolts that hold the transformer and the chassis together. So, guess what I found out? These bolts are subject to creating eddy currents from the magnetic field of your transformer. So what we want to do is insulate these. Okay, I know that sounds like a bunch of horse crap to you, but hey, man, they're recommending that we do it. So how do you do that? Take a wild guess, folks. I took a soda straw, and I know other guys are taking soda straws and doing that, but I'm a picky SOB, and I'm not going to do that. What I did use a soda straw. I put it in there to get a length, okay? To get a length for, I can't get the thing out now. A length for how much of this bolt I have to insulate. Okay, now, what happens is you put a metal washer on your bolt when you do your mounting. Put a metal washer on, a nylon washer. Your insulated bolt, of course, should be insulated at this point. Another nylon washer, a metal washer. And I have lock nuts, and the lock nuts have just instantly become moot at this point. But what this will show me, though, is how much of this bolt, the length of this bolt, including the washers, how much of that bolt has to be insulated. So what I do is put the magic shrink tube, get the bigger stuff. I don't have any bigger. Yeah, I do. That's huge. Oh, okay. Right, here we go. Right, this is flat, not that round stuff. Okay, slide that on there. Slide another chunk of that on there, okay, and figure out the length that we had to do and cut this, okay? Okay, here's the technique now. Figure out with all your washers and get your lock nut or nut in position there. That's how much of that bolt needs to be insulated plus a little bit more, okay? Since these tubes were not really long enough to do it in one big chunk. Okay, I took one and cut it in half and added another one. So let's take all this off, get it out of the way. Okay. Where that was, this nut, the top of this nut was almost flush. Well, let's make it flush for a little bit of go up into room, okay? And that's about where you want to take your awful deadly heat gun and cook that sucker. Yes, folks, cook that sucker 20 minutes per pound at 425 degrees. Cook that thing, overcook it a little bit, maybe it'll shrink it down. Okay, now that should be enough. Now you will know that your bolt is cool enough when you no longer scream when you grab it. Flip this honking beast over. Now, because you have additional circumference now, it might be a little bit snug. When you hit this aluminum transformer saddle, you will find resistance. That hole is, for some reason, slightly smaller. Do everything you can, very short of drilling that hole out. Do not drill that hole. Not that anything is really going to hurt. Yes, it is. Okay, you don't want any aluminum shards in your... Whoop, knocked the light over, Mark. You don't want any aluminum shards inside your transformer windings. Okay, you don't want to short anything out. What you're going to have to do, get your nut driver and work that thing in. Twist it and push it. Oops, hey, you know what I didn't do? I did not put any washers on that yet. Perhaps if I loosen everything else up, get out of the way. Let's loosen everything up so we can draw some stuff around a little bit better. Yeah, there we go. Yeah, that helped. Ah, but then your socket now. You run out of depth there. That container was shut, otherwise all my stuff would have been all over the floor. Okay, now your nylon washer. Lift this hog over again. Nylon washer. Metal washer. And then do that for all four transformer bolts. I almost said transistor bolts. All right.
We begin with a little bit of the wiring infrastructure here. I have here a yellow and orange wire that also connected that terminal strip to the yellow and orange wire that comes from that 12 volt winding of the transformer. This will power the front panel LED meters. Now, at this point, you really need to know something about your house wiring, about hot wires and neutral wires. I marked this H and N because that's how originally this was wired. So still hot will go to the same primary tap, and neutral to the same primary coils of that transformer. Okay, white wires in your house wiring. If you have ever replaced an outlet or a wall switch, white wire is hot. If you have one of those switches that control a light from two places, there's a red wire, but we don't have that right now. Okay, hot wire or neutral wire. Okay, you'll notice this wire is pretty funky stuff. This is military spec, Teflon insulated, really nice stuff. Anyway, no matter how much you heat it with a soldering iron, it does not melt back. It's incredible stuff. Problem is with my wire strippers that I use, the stuff is so slick, sometimes it just unslick, doesn't cut it. Okay, your white neutral. Make sure you have enough wire coming from there to go along, top, down, and you will be adding a NEMA 15P auxiliary output plug. This will go onto that wide blade. Let me verify that. The neutral on that. So when that is installed, that will go from neutral, and then another wire will go to the input plug in there. So I don't, I could have arranged that a little bit better. That C13 plug. Okay. So that also, two wires will come from your hot side. One will return AC also again to that auxiliary input. And one, a shorter wire, will come from your thermal cutoff. Now, I've really had a lot of back and forth thinking about this, and I've decided I'm going to do this my way because I'm just, I don't know, OCD about this stuff. Okay, hot wire is going to have to come from that connector up and to a switch, and then back to a thermal cutoff, then up to the second cutoff, and then to power your transformer. I have a big issue about this now. You don't want anything in here to be at any potential with the power turned off. So, actually, that's going to come from the power connector to the fuse tip, and then to, okay, and then to the rest of the house. Okay, I'll get into more details about that when I figure out what words I'm going to use to describe it. Now, another issue that you're going to have is that this, if you are using the original cabinet from Phase Linear, it's thinner metal. These 115 plugs, they are very hard to get where they will actually go in and lock in to that panel very well. So the worst thing, I mean, you don't want to pull a plug out while there's any electricity applied to this and have those legs short out against the chassis. You may have to take a Dremel tool and modify one of the shoulders. I've done one. You'll have to do both. So you have to modify these shoulders to make sure that this thing clips in correctly. Now, which way does this go in? Wide one to the right or to the left? Go and look at a wall outlet and see how that's arranged and do it the same way, okay?
then you are ready for further mayhem. All right, now let's see what we got. From the power connector, neutral wire, white wire, goes to the neutral side of the auxiliary AC output, AC socket, and then leapfrogs all the way across to the neutral side of the transformer primary. The black wire, which is the hot, goes to the fuse ring, which then will, the power will then go to the through the fuse to the fuse tip and on to all the way over here to this loop, which goes to the power switch. We're leaving this a loop right now for the power-up testing. This will be interrupted by the switch. From this loop, we're going back to a thermal cutoff. Through the thermal cutoff to the next thermal cutoff. From the thermal cutoff, across and down to the primary of the transformer. Okay, notice that I've twisted wires, twisted some AC wires. I've even braided them, to tell you the truth. AC wires. Okay, you want to twist them because when you do that, you eliminate, hopefully eliminate altogether, all AC interference. You don't want any 60 cycle AC buzz entering through into your amplifier, especially because the input from your preamplifier is going to come through these cables here, these coax. They are going to go for that long up to the front panel, to the sensitivity controls, and then from the sensitivity controls, the inputs on the invisible control circuit, which is not in place yet. All right, now, just remember, twist your AC wires. This AC wire will then run to the DC protection circuit. These will be twisted, actually, because I have a ground to connect. I'll probably even want to braid them. These, according to the instructions from the manufacturer of that DC protection circuit, they're telling me to run that wire down the bottom, then up to the AC circuit, or DC circuit, sorry. These wires here, these, again, to be redundant, they're going to power the LED output meters. These are AC too. They are 12 volt AC. They are going to be twisted too. So let's, okay, worry about that when we're stringing up the front panel, okay? That comes later. Here is the neutral bus, this copper bar here between the two power capacitors. And here I have soldered the transformer center tap. These two gray wires are speaker ground, I guess, neutral. Okay, having discussed AC and how your speakers actually aren't positive and negative. And also this white wire here, this white wire, that will be connected to that stud there. This is your single point chassis ground. You have one single chassis point ground. Okay, that eliminates ground loops. That makes sure that you don't have any ground loops. Look at all the dust in that. I'm so embarrassed. I haven't dusted for a while. Anyway, okay, know that that copper sucks up incredible amounts of heat. and I use a very big, massive, awful, brutal, you know, industrial strength soldering iron to do those things. That copper bus bar will take a lot of heat before anything will solder to it. So do that. Okay, you also notice, okay, I've kept the old capacitors for a purpose. You know, these make sure that I have something to hold that still while I solder that on there. So there is your copper bus bar. That is done. Three wires on that. Well, one, two, three, four wires on that. My elementary mathematics fail me right now. But that's what you want to do. There will be more connections to this bus. However, I'm going to use ring terminals on those. Okay. The protection circuit, the front panel LED meters, and the backplane circuits will also need to connect to those. For those connections, however, I'm going to use the little ring terminals that I love so much. They're just going to screw right on there. One for backplane, one for auxiliary stuff like the meter and the DC circuit. All right, okay, ready to go on to the next step. Negative from your rectifier will go to that pole of that capacitor. Positive from that rectifier will go to this pole back here that you can't see because everything's in the way. Okay, in from that, we will have a ring terminal on the end of that. On the end of this wire, another wire inserted also into that ring terminal, which is going to run up to the negative, the B minus, the B negative, the power negative, DC negative, what, you know, come on, Mark, of the fuse holders. Okay, and from the positive on these two upper ones. So, there's a little finagling to go here, and let me do that little assembly, and I'll be back in a trice. Looks like I need to change battery on this camera, too. Okay, these little ring terminals, believe it or not, the holes are big enough that you can stuff two wires in there and solder it in, which is what we've done. We've done a red wire on the B-plus rail of the capacitor. We've also done it on the B negative rail of the capacitor. These two long wires will run to, okay, as you have B negative on the bottom capacitor, you also have that wire going to the bottom two fuse holders. And the same for positive as well. You want to put that on the top just to have it nice. Now, look at that. See that? Look at that. Left and right output stages are independently fused on this amplifier. So that's a massive thing. That's a big deal right there. All right, stereo dogs, I've gotten to the point where I can go no further without starting to add the circuit boards and transistors and tomorrow's haircut day. Anyway, let me show you how far you get, and this is what you should end up with. All right. All righty. How am I going to pick the best words to do all this? Okay. From your power input neutral wire. Okay, let me just go through this one more time. Go to the neutral on that. And go to the neutral all the way up to that. Okay. From your hot. Okay, go to fuse ring, to fuse tip. Go, and you notice that I've braided these. From fuse tip back to this loop, which will be interrupted by a switch. This then traces back to first thermal cutoff, which then leaps to the second thermal cutoff, which then goes to the hot terminal on your transformer. Okay, another hot wire will go from here as well and go all the way back to your auxiliary AC output. Okay, that will be a switched AC output, and I should have bought a cup. I really melted the stuffings out of that. Okay, now that 12 volt winding. Okay, again, twist your AC wires. It reduces crosstalk. It reduces any introduction of hum, so on and so forth. Okay. Oh, okay. And what was I going to show you about that? Oh, yeah, right. The neutral bus. Neutral bus. Okay, you have transformer center tap. Sometimes there are two wires coming from that. Transformer center tap going to two gray wires. And honestly, the color of the wires is irrelevant. The original wire was gray from when I first took this apart. Got it in my grubby hands from FedEx. Okay, originally was a gray wire. Okay, that center tap, that neutral bus, okay, and also has another wire that is going to this stud. This is your chassis ground, your one and only chassis ground. No other ground points to your chassis from that. Okay, notice here, I've got one of those ring terminals here. That feeds up. This is going to be neutral to your LED meters. Okay, another one, another white wire is going to go all the way up there. And that is ground for the DC protection circuit, which attaches to your speaker binding posts. Alrighty then, also you notice braided black wires around there. Those are the two skinny little black wires from your AC input from your rectifier that go to power your DC protection circuit. Now, at the rectifier, you had negative out and positive out. They go accordingly to the negative post of the battery minus capacitor, and the red one goes to the battery positive connector of your power capacitor. All right, and they go from the transformer and also have two wires that go to fuse rings. Okay, battery negative on the bottom, battery positive on the top. All right, now, how can you go wrong, right? Got it all? Feel free to pause the video any place you want to. Now, there are further, there will be, when you put the backplane boards in, another connection to the capacitor neutral bus. Okay, there will be another one of these wonderful little ring and shrink tube arrangements. Notice all my lovely shrink tube. I love that stuff. It's so cool. Anyway, there's going to be another ring terminal here. Whoop. Aim for my fingers. Another ring terminal here. This will be the ground for, or the neutral. I don't know what to call it anymore. Ground or neutral. You know, I'm going to have to explain that AC thing. Anyway, this is your neutral connection for the backplane boards right here. Also, there is a B plus unfused connection that will go to the backplane board as well. But you don't want to, I want to make this so that I could easily have put that wire in there and made all three wires go into that ring terminal. However, if you have a transistor blowout and you have to pull this thing apart, you know, it's better just to have that, so when you remove that screw, your back planes will just come out. Not necessarily that they will. Well, yeah, because, okay, you're removing that and that, so. Okay, I can think of nothing more to tell you at this point other than right now we're at the point of adding the circuit boards. So at this time, get your circuit boards out, check the backs of your circuit boards for solder clumps or anything, and we'll get into that in part eight, I think. Oh well, okay. Alrighty, that's enough for now.